I'm Mingmei, and thank you very much for Dr. C's wonderful introduction. Today, I'm very pleased to be here to talk about the Qin. And before I start, I would like to thank several people, but I don't see Lawrence is helping me with the video, and where is Anthony? I don't see him. He's outside? Okay, it's okay. And I also have to thank my special guest, Geoffrey Redmond, and he's going to demonstrate calligraphy later. And Geoffrey is also my husband. Okay, the title of my lecture tonight is Qin and Calligraphy. And I think most of you know, of course, what calligraphy is, but maybe not all of you know what Qin music is about. So before I start, I will give a brief introduction of this instrument. And those people there, can you see the instrument? I'll give you some background. This instrument is very esoteric. That means not many people learn how to play this instrument. When I started to play it, it's almost like a little more than 30 years ago. There were only a few people who learned to play this instrument, maybe 4, 5. And my teacher was the only teacher in Hong Kong. That means if you want to find another teacher, it's not possible. So it's very esoteric. Nobody even ever heard of this instrument, let alone play it. But now in China, the Qin suddenly has become very popular in recent years. Why? Because a few years ago, it was acknowledged by the United Nations as the intangible inheritance of humanities. Have you heard of that? The intangible inheritance of humanities? So now it becomes very popular, and many people start to play. So let me show you some slides first. So as you can see on the screen, this is the most expensive Qin. This is called Qin, this instrument, and it's also called the seven-stringed zither. And in the past, in China, it was only played by intellectuals. That means literati, we call a learned people. And it was deemed only learned people are worthy to play this instrument. If you are just ordinary people, they are considered, not good enough to play this instrument. So it's supposed to be a very elegant instrument. So you can look at this. This, of course, is the most elegant among all the Qin, or the seven-string zither. This one, as you can see, is heavily decorated with silver and gold. It's very expensive, and it's now in the museum in Tokyo. So the Qin, because it was played by learned people in the past. So ordinary people, you're not supposed to play this instrument because it's supposed to be a sacred, a very elegant instrument. But now in China, it's very popular, so you can see that many musicians play the Qin to a big audience too. In the past, you don't play to a big audience. It's supposed to be very vulgar. You only play to what? You play to flowers, you play to the moon, you play to your intimate friends who really understand music, but not for the public. That's very vulgar. But now, that is what the Qin, the situation of the Qin now. And you can see it's also played with other musical instruments. And people, because it was acknowledged by United Nations, then parents send their little children to learn to play the instrument too. And this you can see, in the past, also learned people, they're supposed to master 4 different kinds of arts. And you can see how to do the pointer. Is it a pointer, this one? Oh, this is not a pointer. It is? Oh, okay. So this is the Qin, the seven-string zither. And the 4 arts are the Qin, the chess, or we call the go. It's an encirclement chess. And painting. And also calligraphy. Or, because in Chinese it's called Qin Xi Shu Hua, the Shu can be calligraphy or it can be books. And of course, most people also excelled in poetry. So if you are learned, educated people in the past, you had to master these 4 arts. Otherwise, you're not considered educated. And so this instrument is a very elegant and very subtle instrument. And you can look at the instrument. I don't want to move it too much because I've just tuned it. It has 7 strings. And the box is lacquered. And it has many layers. So that's why the sound of the instrument is not very loud. Why? Because it was supposed to use for cultivation in the past. It's not supposed to entertain people. You play this instrument, it's not for performance. You are going to like meditation, doing meditation when you play this instrument. So it's very subtle, and we have over 100 different fingers, very complex fingers. And we pay a lot of attention, or we are very particular about the choreography of the fingers, how the fingers look very nice, aesthetically appealing to people. So I think before I go on with the slides, I'm going to play you a very short piece so you can hear what the instrument sounds like for those people who haven't heard it before. I'm going to play a very short piece, and this piece is called the Drinking Spree. And this piece was supposed to be composed about 1,000 years ago. Of course, I mean, we don't know whether this is true or not. And by one of the seven sages of the bamboo grove, they are intellectuals. And in order to avoid political persecution in the past, they either played the instrument to forget about, you know, conflicts in the world, or they get drunk. They got drunk all the time, those intellectuals. And nowadays, I mean, getting drunk in the past is supposed to be very poetic and romantic, but nowadays, of course, they're just alcoholics. So this piece is about drinking and getting drunk. It's called the Drinking Spree. And it can be both played in duple meter and triple meter. And if it's in triple meter, it sounds like this. It also can be played in duple meter. Unusual piece because it's very animated, but most Qin pieces are not like this. They're more subtle and very leisurely. It's not that animated because this is about getting drunk. So why some people play in duple time and some in triple time? In my opinion is, if you drink whiskey, then you play in triple time. But you drink Chinese Mao Tai liquor and then you duple time, because triple time, triple meter is not very often can be heard in Chinese music. So it's more a Western kind of product. So, and this musical instrument, besides that you can play a solo, and in the past, because you only play with a small group of people. Or, of course, I mean, I'm not going into great detail, but anyway, for self-cultivation, you can also play this instrument and sing at the same time. You know, just like, you play the guitar and sing. And the singing style is lost. So, we normally, now, we sing it with natural singing style, because in the past it has this, particular singing style to this instrument. But now, because it's lost, or we use natural singing style, sometimes we borrow operatic singing style. So now I'm going to sing also a short piece, and the lyrics of this piece is from the Ode of Song. The text was very, very old text. It's a love song. Actually, this probably is the oldest Chinese love song. It's about a man agonizing for his desire for a beautiful woman. And actually, different music were, have been composed for this text. But this one is composed by me, this music. Because all the music that I heard in the past, they're a little bit too, not anxious enough. Because if you're so passionate, you really want the beautiful woman, you really have to go after it. You have to have some passion and anxiety instead of too leisurely. So this is my music, and I think I have some handout for the text. It's about a man agonizing for a beautiful woman. Qin music and calligraphy. And that's fine, thank you. Calligraphy has been very popular, of course, as a form, art form in Chinese culture. Of course, I mean, nowadays writing has been somewhat replaced by computer. Most youngsters, they just type into the computer. And more and gradually, calligraphy more like an art form rather than a for functional purpose. You know, you write letters in the past, you know, we wrote letters with, you know, our handwriting instead of the computer. This is a picture showing youngsters doing calligraphy in China in a school. And of course, I'm sure everyone recognizes who he is. This is Chairman Mao. Chairman Mao is a very renowned calligrapher as well as a poet. And this is, you know, doing calligraphy, and this is one of his calligraphy. And this is during the Cultural Revolution. That is, you know, they want to destroy the traditional culture. And actually, calligraphy was very useful then, because the red guard, you know, the little red guard, and she was writing what we call the big character posters. And that is for a political purpose, either to condemn someone or for different kinds of slogans. And so she's writing, you know, using calligraphy to write this kind of posters. And the Qin is the Chinese instrument which has been associated with calligraphy. And through the centuries, many Qin players were also accomplished calligraphers because they regard the two art form quite similar. And then I'll tell you why they are similar. This is especially the use of lines in calligraphy, the use of melodic lines in Qin music, and also the use of space. And this lady, she's my Qin teacher. I learned to play the Qin from her. And as I have told you, she was the only teacher in Hong Kong that. And when this picture was taken, she was 83 years old. And when you practice this instrument, or you practice calligraphy, because it's to calm you down, not to excite you. It's a quiet instrument, because it's amplified, of course. If it's with no amplification, actually it's very, very soft and subtle. So it's not to excite people, but to calm you down. So that's why we believe that playing the Qin or doing calligraphy, you can live a long life. So my teacher is a perfect example because he's 102 this year. She's in Hong Kong, 102. She does both calligraphy and she's a very accomplished calligrapher. And this is me doing calligraphy. And this is one of my calligraphy, one of my work. It's a Buddhist text. And this is another of my calligraphy, but this is quite unusual because if you don't play the tune, of course, you don't know what that is. Actually, this is notation for my instrument. This is the notation for the Qin. And we call it tablature, actually, because it doesn't indicate pitch. And I'm going to tell you about the similarities between Qin music and calligraphy. And calligraphy, as we all know, we use lines. Chinese people, especially Chinese arts, we actually use lines and space, basically. Calligraphy is one of the best examples, as you can see. And besides lines, we also use dots and blots. And you can see lines, very elegant lines. It's not straight lines. We rarely use straight or geometrical lines, but graceful, curvy, and organic lines. So calligraphy is a good example of this. You can see all these different kinds of lines. And you can see the dots. And this is a little bit, you can call it the blot, that means the... And this, actually, this calligraphy, if you want to see the real work, I think it's showing now at the map, so you can go and take a look. Another piece of calligraphy. And you can see that this is a line, right? But you can see the dots within the line. And this is, of course, it's very difficult. It's not easy to do. It's because you have to exert different force onto the brush. Since Chinese brush are very soft, so if you exert different force onto the brush and onto the paper, and then you can have different kinds of effects. So this is one of the dots within lines, which I find very unusual. And this is another piece of calligraphy. And of course, I mean, Chinese calligraphy, because it's all lines. Music also is all lines. So how to make these lines interesting to look at or interesting to listen to? Because line can become monotonous after a while. So you give variations to the lines. And the variations are, you can either have very dry ink, you can see here, dry ink, or very wet, you can see here, very wet, or pale. So this is my calligraphy. So you can see the variations in lines. Actually, in music, it's the same thing as I've just said. We have more than 100 different fingerings to enrich one single melodic line, because Qin music, as you already heard, is monophonic. We have only one single melodic line. So we use different fingerings to enrich, to give variations to the lines.
And then, so the criteria are the wetness or the dryness of the line, right?
This is to give variations to the lines.
Right. Yeah. What you're saying about that?
Yeah.
What about, it looks like you've got kind of a blurry outline and you've got a sharper line too. Is that another criteria?
I won't use the word criteria. Criteria, that means you have to do this. But it's different people. You can, you know, I mean, maybe one piece of calligraphy is all dry ink, or another piece is all wet ink to achieve a certain aesthetic goal. So, but we do give, these are all the different kinds of variations you see in calligraphy. But doesn't mean that one piece of calligraphy has to have all these criteria, as you said. Doesn't have to. It depends on different style of calligraphy. Some you don't. But most, like cursive style, we have more variations. Like earlier form of calligraphy, then we didn't have like very wet ink like this. Yeah, because it's still, you know, I don't know how to put it. Yeah, but it's different ways of doing it. But it's not a must. Yeah. And as you can see, besides... the variations of the lines, we can also space. You can see the space. This is the character. My Chinese friends here should know what this character is, right? This is the character for the word wind. And you can see that also very wet on purpose, and then very pale. And another interesting thing, you can see that one stroke, you have very pale and darker ink in one stroke. And that is very interesting, because actually that shows the yin-yang polarity in Chinese culture. Because Chinese culture, everything is yin-yang. We look at everything yin and yang. So this calligrapher, he's a contemporary. He's able, you know, to have the yin-yang in one stroke. And another interesting thing is a lot of empty space, right, left in the character. And that is done on purpose, because the yin-yang polarity, and also because you need the emptiness to bring out the strokes. So most of the time, Qin music or calligraphy or painting the same. The background, we don't feel it in the background. And that's the emptiness in the Chinese philosophy. And this emptiness, of course, I'm not going to in detail, but it's influenced by Taoism. Because we all return to the original source. And the original source, of course, is nothingness. It's because of this nothingness, it generates 10,000 different things. So the background is always left empty. And besides the background is empty, for the calligraphic strokes, we also have empty space. Like this one, actually, I have the other example already. You can see this is almost nothing, right? And this is called the flying white. In Chinese, it's called the fei bai, flying white. And actually, this is considered to be of high aesthetic value in Chinese painting and calligraphy. Because let me tell you a joke. I had a friend, he was a calligraphy teacher, and one time he told me he showed a piece of calligraphy with all these flying whites. Oh, I'm sorry. With all these flying whites to someone who doesn't know anything about calligraphy. And then the person said, oh, poor guy, you don't have enough money to buy ink. So he picked up, you know, some brush and ink and fill in all the empty space. And of course, I mean, that is considered something. Well, the literati is something extremely vulgar. What we value of high aesthetic value is those empty space left. Why? Because, as I said, besides the yin-yang polarity, this represents the, you know, the emptiness, the interplay between full and emptiness, and also because with the empty space in a painting and calligraphy, we feel that we can feel, when we look at a piece like that, we can feel the calligrapher's breathing. We can all actually feel his breath, his energy, his qi in those empty space. And another main reason is because that's very important in Chinese culture, is because with all the empty space, we think that we can rest our spirit. We can rest our spirit in all this empty space. If everything is filled, then you just feel too constricted or too stuffy or whatever you put it. So you need to have empty space. And this is another of my calligraphy. And the empty space can be done in a way which is reverse. That means I did not use the brush and write the word Buddha. This is the word Buddha. But I use the ink, fill in the ink, and leave this empty. So it becomes the word Buddha. So it's another way to show emptiness. And I can tell you, of course, this is not easy to do. And I'm going to show you emptiness in painting. When Chinese artists do a dragon, they paint a dragon, they rarely paint the whole dragon. I mean, of course, illustration is different. They always, the dragon, parts of the body of the dragon is always covered by clouds or mist. And this is actually intentionally to leave emptiness, to leave, you know, empty space in the painting, for us to rest our spirit, as I said, or you can feel the breathing of the artist. You don't fill up every space. And also to render the dragon much more appealing because it's more mysterious. Another example of emptiness, you know, empty and full in a painting. And we just leave, you know, the whole area blank. So, of course, you know that there is the, that's the sea, but we don't have to fill it in. And there is another, actually a famous painter. And this one, this is calligraphy, and this is painting, and this is seal. And all consist of lines, and they all combine together. And then you don't have to paint the water, right? But you can feel that the fish is, you know, swimming in water. So this is an example of Western painting, how they do fish. It's completely filled in, you know, cram in as many as possible. But of course, I picked the extreme example. It doesn't mean that all Western paintings are like this. So this is another example of a Western artist, and this is Matisse. He likes to use lines and leaves all, you know, a lot of empty space. Oh, let me go back. And maybe I can, I should go on to talk about the empty space used in Qin music. Yeah, I just mentioned because Qin music is monophonic. That means we use only one single melodic line. We don't have harmony as in Western music, nor polyphony. We don't have anything like that for Qin. Just one single melodic line. And as I said, the single melodic line can get very monotonous after a while. So we embellish the lines with different fingerings when we have over 100. And let me demonstrate one fingering that we use all the time is called the, I use the English word vibrato, but of course in Chinese it's not called a vibrato. And it's a long to and fro movement of the finger. And when you first play it like this, we do it from 6 to 8 times. And as you can tell, the first time you can hear it, right? The second time, it may be, you know, you can hear a little bit, but then after the third time, it's almost inaudible. But then you ask why it's inaudible since it's music. But that's how Chinese stretch it, just like the empty space in a painting or in calligraphy. So we do it like this long vibrato. There is a lot of empty space left. And one extreme fingering is you don't even have to play. You don't have to move the fingers. It's supposed that you just rest the finger on the string and the pulsation of your blood can vibrate on the string. And I'm talking about Qin music can be that subtle. But that was in the past. Nowadays, you cannot do anything like this because in the past, we have, more antique instruments were available, and then the sound is better. And also, as I said, you don't play it, you know, in a big audience like this. And also, it's relative because in the past we didn't have that much noise pollution. It's very, very quiet, so actually you can hear it. And another very interesting and important thing is, and the Qin players, they believe we can hear it with our finger. We don't have to really hear it with our ears. We hear it with our finger. But I can tell you, I mean, I don't mean really here, but that is true because we enjoy the kinesthetic element in playing the Qin. So you can actually, the finger, you feel the sound, you feel the rubbing of your finger against the instrument, and you really enjoy that feeling, and that is enough. Because as I said, it's not for to entertain you, it's not for performance, it's just for meditation, for self-cultivation. And also, I demonstrate a little fingering here is because, as I said, this instrument, as you look at it, it has no bridges, no frets. So you actually can play from here up to here. That means you can obtain long melodic lines on the instrument. This line is not embellished because I have to play quickly, and this is actually from a piece called The Flowing Water. This is to describe the flowing water. And I think this is the only instrument in the world that can play long lines like this. So it's very similar to calligraphic lines. And on the other hand, calligraphy, we also use a lot of dots, right, as I show you. And on the Qin is also one of the very few instruments in the whole world that use a lot of dots. And this is played with the harmonics. We have three different kinds of timbres. The harmonics, pitch from the open strings, and also stopped pitch, just like like this. Okay, so harmonics actually are dots, just like calligraphy. And not many instruments, you can play the harmonics in a whole piece just composed of harmonics, or long passages with harmonics. So I demonstrate a long passage of harmonics. Many instruments, as I said, have dots like this. And so, any more questions before I go on?
What do you mean by dots? Is that when you dance with like on
yeah, the because the fingertips only hit on a very narrow point on the instrument. But like this is not as different. We have blots, like calligraphy blots. I mean, you have a bigger surface. The fingering. You have a bigger surface on the instrument, but you also you have a very narrow surface on the instrument, just like dots. That's my point. Any?
Yes, I'm just curious if contemporary classical Chinese composers are now scoring for that instrument like that. These scores would be from the fingering off of the mat. And
can you, one more time?
Tan Dun,
the Chinese, probably
one of the famous Chinese.
Oh, Tan Dun, yeah, of course.
He is scoring for that instrument in his scores, either.
Yeah, he composed. He composed. Have you seen the movie Hero? There's a movie called Hero from China, a very popular movie. That was composed by Tan Dun, I believe. Yeah. And in the movie Hero, that is the instrument.
Wow.
This is the instrument played in the movie Hero. Yeah, if you have seen that. But the piece was composed by Tan Dun, but I don't think he plays the Qin. He doesn't play the instrument.
No, I'm not saying okay. I'm just saying what he used in his orchestration, there would be passages where the Qin would be used in the overall score of the movie of the opera. Sounds like in this movie score, it's used.
I think he took some passages from some traditional pieces and kind of rearranged it. And I was told that, of course, because since he doesn't play the instrument, so he composed the melodies, and then Qin players like myself, you arrange it onto the instrument.
Right.
Yeah, so when I compose for the Qin song, the singing, and I also have to arrange the fingerings on the instrument, and that is, not a very easy task, because some people, they compose the melody, but they don't know how to transpose the fingering onto the instrument. So they have to ask another person to do the fingering.
Right.
Doesn't mean that one person will do everything. No. Sometimes they compose the music and ask a Qin person to write down the fingering. Because since I'm not following my notes, since I can't really read earlier. And I want to mention one thing since I remember now. And emptiness in Qin music or in calligraphy of painting, because we feel that the artists, they can linger the spirit in the emptiness. And for the Qin, the same thing, because when you do this, as I said, it's getting softer and softer, the sound. Like this. Geoffrey, quite soft, right? But actually, Qin players like myself, you enjoy doing this. You enjoy very much because your fingerings are rubbing against the soundboard, and it's a very enjoyable sensation. Why is it enjoyable? It's because there is a theory. I don't know whether it's true or not. It's a Chinese medicine theory. It's because our fingers are filled with, according to Chinese medicine, with meridian points. So we have different meridian points at the different tips of our fingers. So when I rub my, you know, this part of my finger against the soundboard, actually I'm massaging a certain meridian point, and that can lead to good health and longevity. And that explains why, you know, I won't say all, but most Qin players live a long life. It's because, you know, we have this favorable, what do you call it, thing when playing the Qin. And as I want to add one thing, is silence or emptiness of music or calligraphy or painting must always be contrast and or balanced with the actual sound. Of course, if you have no sound, that doesn't mean anything. Or it should be balanced or contrast with the actual ink in a piece of calligraphy. Otherwise, the emptiness or the silence is completely meaningless. And the best example is, you know about John Cage, the contemporary musician. He composed a piece called the 4 minutes 33 seconds, and it's a piece completely no sound. And when I was a visiting scholar in Huddersfield in England, actually I met him, John Cage in person, and he performed this piece, you know, 4 minutes and 33 seconds, 33, right? And it's a piano piece. And actually, he hired, or he invited, a very famous pianist from Singapore. And she went to the grand piano and sit down, and there is even the piano notation, the score. So she opened the score, of course it's empty, there's the score. And then there are three movements to the piece, and then the first movement is like this, for I don't know how long, maybe 5 minutes, and then the second movement like this. And then the third movement like this, and finished. And to me, that doesn't mean anything, really. But John Cage claimed that he composed this piece, he was inspired by the I Ching, the Book of Change in China. And I wonder, but none of Chinese artists, you know, did anything like that, completely empty, which to me is somewhat meaningless. But it's interesting that he introduced this idea, of course, I mean, to the West. And another important thing in Chinese culture is the return to nature, and this is influenced by Taoism, because we always said we should return to nature. So calligraphy also based, calligraphic strokes always based on different images in nature, and so as Qin fingerings, I have to speed up. And this is different calligraphic strokes, a dot, you know, what do you call this? And a straight line or whatever, and it either imitates nature, the natural image of a drifting cloud or a falling rock. And Qin music is the same. This is a fingering which should imitate the light wind, and another fingering which should imitate the petals flowing on the river. So it's a very elegant and very subtle image. And now I think, okay, now actually I conclude my talk by showing you the use of lines, more examples of the use of lines in Chinese culture. And I, of course, I talk about calligraphy and painting, but I'm going to repeat a little bit. And this is the earliest form of Chinese writing, earliest. It's about 3,000 years old. And this is called the oracle bones. Have you heard of the oracle bones? And it is actually, we don't write on it, but we use a knife, a sharp knife, and to, you know, cut onto the very hard, either turtle's shell or animal bones. And the purpose is for divination. And as you can see, in oracle bones, this earliest form of Chinese writing, we already have kind of circular lines. So Chinese lines, as I said, is never really geometrical or straight. Always curve around, because that is how you think is appealing to the eyes. And this is a Chinese seal, seal, and you can see that it's also use of different kinds of lines, straight lines, and also curved lines. And you can see this line, you might think that because the seal is kind of damaged, but actually sometimes the carver, they deliberately break up the lines on purpose, so you can feel the emptiness, you can feel the breathing of the artist. So it's deliberate sometimes. Sometimes, of course, it's damaged, like if it's a very ancient, antique seal, it might be damaged. And can you guess? I'm sure some people know what that is. This is a religious magic figure, or we call it the incantation. Actually, the purpose is either to expel or invoke good luck or bad luck. So let's say if you don't like someone, you ask a religious priest, mostly Taoist priest, to write an incantation as a curse to someone. So you can use, this is illustrate is use of lines, do a lot of straight and as well as circular lines. And this is a Chinese painting, and this is from a Dunhua. And you can also see very elegant use of lines. And this is a flying goddess, Apsara, flying bodhisattva. And even if you fill in a painting, you fill in with color, you can see, it's all outlined with lines. And this is my painting. And this is Guan Yin, the goddess of compassion. And this is another of my painting. And other goddess of compassion that you can see is all outlined first, different kinds of lines. And this goddess is relaxing by the lotus pond. It's a famous motif for Guan Yin painting. This is another of my painting, and this is a combined calligraphy, you know, painting and also lines of seal. And the writing text is the Heart Sutra, the most popular Buddhist scripture, we call it, sutra. And this is someone else's work, it's just Shi Ke, but I'm not going into detail of the painter. And you can see that actually he's using calligraphic lines in the painting. And also you can see the seal is also composed of very curvy and elegant lines. Another painting which illustrates the use of lines and like calligraphy, but it's a painting. And this is Chinese opera. Chinese opera also manifested in a lot of aspects by lines, and especially is the long sleeve, because when they move, the long sleeve is actually manifestation of lines in Chinese opera too. And of course there are other examples, but I'm not going into those. And this is actually a modern dance, also long sleeve. This is another dance by a very famous dance group in Taiwan, and you can see, the long sleeve. And actually, besides long sleeve dance, which illustrate lines in Chinese culture, and the ribbon dance, the dragon dance, they all illustrate lines. And this is martial arts, the Tai Chi sword, and all the different movements of the form in Tai Chi also actually manifest lines, very elegant lines. And as you can see, it's very elegant lines. And this is flower arrangement. And you can see it's arranged in the form almost like a cursive calligraphy. And this actually echo with the calligraphy at the background. And that's the most impressive line in Chinese culture is the Great Wall. And it was rumored if you were on the moon, if you look down on the earth, you can see one line. And that is the Great Wall, whether it's true or not, I don't know. And that is the manifestation of line, ultimate manifestation in Chinese culture. And Chinese like to burn incense, so in a while when I do calligraphy or play the Qin, I'm going to burn incense too. And the reason of burning incense is for several purposes. First, you can purify the air around you, and you can focus your spirit, and also as a communication, because incense always go up, so it communicates with heaven, because Chinese always talk about the union, you know, with heaven, man, and earth. So incense also, because I take these pictures because it really looks like calligraphic lines. But then the other day, I also saw a picture of someone smoking, also had this kind of elegant line for smoking. That's no good, that kind of lines from smoking. And of course, I mean, not only Chinese use lines, actually all cultures use lines, but the use is a different kind of use. So let's look at some Western artists' use of lines. And this is Bryce Martin, he also uses lines, but as you can tell, that not much variation among the lines. But I mean, of course, this is not absolute. And actually, there is his show in the MoMA museum. So if you're interested, you can see his own, this kind of work. But actually, I did see some of his other work. He imitated Chinese calligraphy, used ink and brush. Another artist, Jackson Pollock, he's very famous in his use of lines. And you look at this picture. You can say that he's doing Chinese cursive calligraphy, right? I mean, instead of a painting, because I think it's very similar to another famous Chinese calligrapher's work. This is Wang Duo, very similar. And you can see this person, Wang Duo's lines, completely continuous, right? No break up the flow, it's continuous flow of calligraphic lines. And this is another of Jason Collect's work, and you can say it's painting, you can say it's a contemporary kind of calligraphy. And as I said, you can see the lines, the dots, and the space, very similar to Chinese calligraphy. And this is not by Pollock, it's by a Chinese calligrapher, contemporary, but they do look very similar, right? So this is done by a calligrapher. And this one is done by Picasso. You thicken the lines and then it becomes, you know, like a painting. And so I show you another example because he's using like ink, but very thick ink. He has the flying white too. You can see this, you know, it's very similar to Chinese calligraphic strokes. This is another Chinese calligraphy. It is very wet ink. So it's very similar to, it's all, but of course, this is only a detail for another bigger piece of calligraphy. That's the end of the lecture. So I'm going to play you a few more pieces and then we'll demonstrate calligraphy. Thank you. The first piece is called the Three Variations of the Plum Blossom. Plum Blossom actually is a symbol of Chinese gentleman. That means a virtuous person. And also because plum blossom the flower can survive the bitterest winter. So it's actually a symbol for righteousness, for your toughness. It's a symbol in Chinese culture. So actually painters like to paint plum blossom a lot. And this is a plum blossom, a Qin piece about the plum blossom. And this is a rather animated piece, not those very quiet piece. And it has it's called the Three Variations of the Plum Blossom because there are three identical melodies play on the harmonics and on the different registers of the Qin. Thank you. From the second piece, I'm going to sing the second piece. I think in the program is the Immortal of the Magpie, which, okay. And this is a very famous poem. It's a love story. It's a very sad love story about the separation of lovers. And one sentence is based on the legend of the spinning girl and the cowherd boy, is because they were separated by the heavenly king, so they can only see each other once a year on the seventh month of the seventh. It's in the poem. So it's very sad. It's a sad song, and the music is by me. Let me try first. As you read in the lyrics, the most famous popular phrases about the whole poem is, if love is to last forever, I mean, the lovers, they don't really have to be together. And that that phrase that has been very, very influential. So for people, you know, lovers cannot get together, they always use that to comfort themselves. But of course, it's a lie, right? I mean, it's not true. If you love someone, you want to be with that person all the time instead of, okay, it's enough. We think of each other, but you don't really have to see each other. That's a lie, in my opinion. Okay. And the third one, What is the third one?
Oh,
okay. This is the music is by me. The lyric is by a very famous emperor in Chinese history. But his life is very, very tragic, and at the end, he killed himself, something like this. And all his poems are very, very popular, but they're all very sad. And this one is called The Joy of Encounter, but actually there's not that much joy in my opinion, because there's one phrase you can read in the translation that and they're getting drunk, and they and I assume the other girl is the other person is a woman, because he said it's Tear of the Rouge. That means because she was in tears, and then it kind of smear the rouge on her face, and they get drunk to forget the pain. There is another one, is from the Tao Te Ching. Actually, that one is I'm going to play it in the company to Geoffrey's calligraphy. So, and this is so this is now for the time in the last one is the cry of the raven. And raven actually in Chinese culture is supposed to bring not good luck, but this piece is supposed to bring you all good luck, because there is a story and you can read the story. It's someone heard the crying of the raven, and then he his concubine, because he was, you know, kind of wanted person by the king, and then his concubine heard the cry of the raven, and then she predicted he would go free the other day. It's good news rather than bad news. It's a good thing. So, and that is what happened. And this is a very animated piece. It's not like ordinary Qin pieces. Actually, some of the Qin musicians, they refuse to play this piece, because saying that it's too vulgar, because it's too animated, it's too lively, it's very vulgar. They like those, as I said, very, very soft and almost inaudible. So this is a very animated piece.